Gloucestershire.
Unmuted.
One day you'll leave this world behind, so live a life you will remember. My father told me when I was just a child, these are the nights to never die. My father told me. He said one day you'll leave this world behind, so live a life you will remember. My father told me when I was just a child, these are the nights to never die. My father told me.
Hello everyone, welcome to our virtual farm tour around Gloucestershire farms as part of the Royal Three Counties Show, which we're delighted, despite the unusual circumstances, we're able to deliver something this year. My name is Will Fraser. I am the NFU County Advisor for Gloucestershire, where we represent about 1,100 farming businesses. And what we want to do today is to be able to show you around some of those farms. So we've got 8 farmers lined up from across the county, and we're really keen to show you what they've been up to and what's been going on. I don't know if you've seen in the messaging function on the side of Microsoft Teams, but the rough plan is I will give you a bit of an introduction to the farmers that we will have on the tour in just a moment, and then we will go through a sequence of short films, 3 to 5 minutes of each farm, and after that you'll have the opportunity to ask questions direct to those farmers who are all live on the call today. You can ask those questions in the messaging function, in the chat function as we go along, so please do just put any thoughts, any comments, any questions that you might have in there, and yeah, we've got a whole team here ready and waiting to hope to give you some answers. Yeah, we expect the tour to take roughly an hour and 10 minutes, subject to how many questions that we get, and yeah, we're really looking forward to showing you around the farms. Just a little bit of housekeeping before we get started. Just a note that this meeting is being recorded. That's mainly so that we can just show people who weren't able to join at this time and they can watch it on catch up. You've all been very good at ensuring that your all your microphones are muted and your cameras are off. And just feel free to chip in with your comments as we go along. So without further ado, we should have our farmers on the screen now. If you've got your video on at the moment and you're not a farmer as part of the tour, please could you turn it off? That would be really helpful. And I'm just going to make some quick introductions and then we'll get straight into the tours. So the first person I'd like to introduce you to is James Cox. He is our county chairman for Gloucestershire NFU. And James will be taking your questions and putting them to our farmers and members throughout this tour. So you'll see a fair bit of him, as well as being able to have a look around his farm and his crops down near Kingscote, near Tetbury. Second person I'd like you to introduce you to is Lizzie Dyer, who runs a goat business called Just Kidding, down just south of Cirencester, and we'll hear shortly more about what she's been up to. The third person I'd like to introduce you to is Edward Horton, who runs a mixed arable and livestock operation near Poulton in the Cotswolds. And he's got a lot of interesting ideas about integrated farm management, and talk to you particularly about his crops and how they work in harmony with the environment. Next person I'd like to introduce you to is Liz Godsell, dairy farmer and cheesemaker near Stroud. And she will be showing you a day in the life of a dairy farmer through the view of her daughter, Lily, but will be on hand to answer your questions. And then next, I'd like to introduce David Barton. He'll be talking about his suckler beef herd up in the Cotswolds, and also just a little bit about the impact of the dry weather. We've had some remarkable times in terms of the climate over the last 6 months in this county, and we'll be able to talk a bit about the impact of that. And then we'll go further north up the Cotswolds to Chipping Camden to meet Rob Harrison, another dairy farmer, and also doing excellent work with on-farm education and school visits. And then we'll head further down to see Charles Day in Winchcombe, just outside Cheltenham, who's just put in a new cider and perry orchard, and we'll be able to have a look around that and how that's all going and getting established. And then finally, last but by no means least, we'll have Chris Rumming from down south of Cirencester near Swindon, and he'll be talking to you about all sorts of things, his cattle, his sheep, his hedges, and he's got a real affinity for dung beetles as well. He likes getting his hands in cowpats, so we'll see how that goes. Anyway, enough of the introductions. What we'll do, we'll dive straight on into the first film. Please post your comments, and then you will, you'll probably see James next, asking some questions to Lizzie. So the first film and the first farm that we're going to go to today will be Lizzie Dyer of Just Kidding. And hopefully I can now make the technology work to show you that film.
Billy's that were actually day grazing.
Hello, I'm Lizzie and I run Cotswold Kids Meet, also known as Just Kidding, with my partner Jamie, and we're based on the outskirts of Cirencester, right on the border between Gloucestershire and Wiltshire, and these are some of the kids that we farm here. When we started the business back in 2013, it was a bit of a dive into the unknown. We were the only farm that was looking to take the dairy billies from an indoor setting that they're used to into an outdoor setting, and looking at a more sustainable framework that would allow us to finish them off grass. It's been a huge learning curve over the last 7 years, and we're always looking to adapt and develop our systems, but we are now the largest free-range producer of dairy kid meat in the country. It's a meat that's very similar to lamb in terms of the cuts that you can get from it and how you cook it, but it's much leaner. Nutritionally, it's a superfood. It's lower in cholesterol than chicken, yet has more iron in it than beef. And obviously the way we're producing it here, we're taking it from a dairy industry, so it's not being born and raised for meat. It is a byproduct from another industry, and we're trying to raise it as best we can in a low impact way. So it's probably quite useful to explain the journey of the billies here from the start. And this is a good group to show you. So we work with one dairy farm that milk just shy of 1,000 nannies, and they're milking for Waitrose for goat's milk, and they also milk for a cheese processor. Our relationship with them is that we take every billy born from that dairy and we rear them on to produce a sustainable, award-winning, high-quality meat at the end. So the boys arrived to us when they're about a week old. So this is these guys arrived on Friday last week, so they're quite young, so it shows you the sort of age and size. They are on a system where you can see those teats there, and they get to drink milk 24/7 as if mum was there. So once they're trained to drink on those teats, they're available as if mum was there. These guys will give you an idea of how quickly they grow and develop. They've been with us about 3 weeks now. These guys here arrived to us in April, so you can see that they've really shot up. There's some quite big boys in here. Again, they're still on the milk, same system as you can see, but we've started to introduce some other forage for them to eat, and they are in those troughs got a little bit of hard feed, because that's how we transition them from milk off the milk, and then eventually you'll see they'll be out into the fields that you can see in the distance. So this is the beginning of life off site. This is the first group of kids that we've moved off the main farm. We do a lot of grazing outside of the farm, and these are the first guys to move. It's the start of quite a long summer of keeping enough grass in front of them and the logistics of moving them and keeping them off site. As you can see, a shelter moves with them, water, you know, everything. They have to be self-sufficient. But they are here and they're happy. And as you can see, they've got an abundance of grass. They particularly like this field. There's lots of trees, and they'll shelter all under the trees and play in them. These boys here have just had a new section of grass today. You can see where they were and what they've gone on to. What's so interesting and unique about goats, and obviously in this case billy kids, is the diversity of the grass that they will eat. So you can see straight away that they'll eat the cow parsley and all sorts of bits. This ground here is just classic sort of permanent pasture that's just been allowed to grow very naturally. The area that's really interesting to look at of land management and grazing management is this here. So you can see that this is an overgrown area that's got a lot of nettles, obviously lots of cow parsley, and complete diversity of fauna. There are so few grazing farm animals that would go through it like these boys do. I mean, you can see what they're eating here, and it's full of rich species which will have increased insect life, and it's amazing. It's what we need to see in fields, but it also needs managing naturally. And instead of strimming it or mowing it, these guys do what they're naturally meant to do and manage the land. If you look back, you can see under all these trees behind us where they've grazed, it would have looked the same. And you can see that they tidy it all up. So you'll see this is one of the billies that were actually day grazing. So they are in one of our barns at night, and they come out each morning like this, and they come out to graze during the day. And they're rushing down because today they're on a new section of grass. So we strip graze them, so they get new grass every couple of days. So you can see this is where they have been, where they are, and when they'll go to. Docks, they go for the docks straight away. And thistles, that's where you can see them all grouping around the interesting bits. So that's why goats are quite good with grazing, because they'll graze a field down very differently to any other animal. It's a much more natural way of grazing. They browse, and they like all different types of species and fauna, so they'll graze a field very evenly, which is helpful. As you'll see, they are completely unique to farm and to have about. They're not, you know, they're not particularly tame, you know, these are farm animals, but they're very inquisitive. They chew for England. I don't think I've got any clothing left that hasn't got a hole in. And it does mean that managing them in general is quite tricky. They're highly intelligent. They're like Houdini, they're very good at escaping. And they're not frightened of anything. So moving them between fields or the barns, they follow us. We can't herd them, we can't work them with dogs like you might see with sheep. So it's been a complete learning curve farming them because you have to learn how they need to be managed and adapt accordingly.
So that was our first film with Lizzie. And James, over to you.
Yep. Okay, well, welcome everybody. And thank you very much indeed for joining us today. And thank you very much, Lizzie, for you being the first video up. We've got a few questions come in already. So the first one was asking about whether you have to dehorn and castrate the billies as you do cattle.
So we don't dehorn the billies. They will at the dairy, but we have taken the management decision to leave them with their horns to keep it as natural as possible. They are castrated. They're castrated in the same way that you castrate lambs. So it's done at an early stage, and that's predominantly for a management decision and also for the meat quality.
Brilliant. Thank you. And next question is asking about how long you keep the billies in their various sections. So obviously we saw them in the groups inside, and then also when you start moving them outside, and what sort of size area do they have for their grazing?
So what we tend to do is we will fence an entire field like you would with cattle and sheep. And then what we found, and it took a little bit of time to learn this, that because of their browsing nature, if you just give them the entire field in one go, they'll walk around it, have a browse round, have a mute round, and then they get bored of it. So what we do is we strip graze them. So we separate each field into small sections, and we try and give them new grass every sort of 2 to 3 days, depending how much they've eaten. And that way they think they're getting somewhere new, and they'll actually eat the grass in a much more constructive manner.
And the next question is about, do they fight much between themselves being billies, or do they get along well?
We've not actually had a problem. They will butt each other and play and what have you, but we've not had any injuries from them, you know, fighting between themselves. We keep them in the same age group, so there's no sort of hierarchy in terms of the older ones and the younger ones, which I think helps a great deal.
And next question was about, how do you know when they're ready to kill, ready to go to slaughter? So, and I was going to ask you the sort of question, you know, what sort of length of time do you actually keep a billy?
So we did quite a bit of work on this and sort of experimenting, because there was no blueprint. For what we're trying to produce, which is a sort of genuine kid meat, we tend to find that it's between 6 and 9 months old. It does vary slightly because we're finishing them off grass, and we let everyone go at their own rate. They don't all finish at the same time, but it's 6 to 9 months on average, and we tend to do it by weighing. So we get an idea of what weight they need to be for them to produce the carcass that our customers are looking for.
So does that mean that you keep them over the winter months?
Yeah, we do. So we're all year round because the dairy we work with, he will be kidding. He will kid his nanny, so his female goats, at different times of the year for milk supply. So we will get an intake of new kids 4 times a year. So we've got billies here all year round, and there's a constant flow.
And Lizzie, how do you market the meat? And I know that obviously with COVID, you've had a challenge there, but maybe you want to just tell us how you've managed to slightly overcome that challenge as well.
Yeah, we have, because we direct sell. So whether that's to, you know, customers, Joe Public, or to the restaurants, our business model, because it's quite a niche product, has been more to the restaurant trade. So obviously with COVID, we had a bit of a shock to the system because we lost the restaurants practically overnight. But we've got a very loyal client base, and through sort of social media
and website and what have you. We direct sell and courier across the country. So it's just been a period of adjustment.
Final probably couple of questions before we move on, I guess, to keep in time. But one was just asking what the breed was, and are there any common health issues you have with the billies? And a final question on the actual weight of the billies at slaughter.
Okay. So breed-wise, they're all dairy breeds. So you've got the ones that were white are your equivalent of your black and white Friesian cow. They're the mainstay of the goat dairy industry. The breed is called Saanen. People pronounce it differently. Then you've got a British Alpine, which are the ones that are black and white. And then you've got Toggenburg, which are the brown ones. They're the three main dairy breeds that are dairy ewes. So they're the breeds, obviously, that come through our billies. They're not boars, which is a question that came up. The boars are a specific goat meat breed, where we're obviously taking a byproduct from the dairy industry. In terms of weight, it varies. We're looking normally, so when it is a live weight and they're still on farm, it's normally between 35 and 40 kilos, which may seem quite a broad spectrum of weight, but they do vary within that spectrum. And the carcasses are normally between 15 and 17 kilos as an average.
Lizzie, thank you very much indeed. I think for anybody else who's still got questions, if Lizzie's able to see the chat, she'll write some answers where she can to those. So please, if you've got further questions on Lizzie's video, but say to keep the time, I think, Will, we need to move on to Ed, I believe it is now.
Yeah, thank you very much, James. Thank you very much, Lizzie. And without further ado, we'll go to our next farm just up the road at Poulton with Ed Horton.
Hi, my name's Ed Horton and welcome to our virtual farm tour here on our home farm at Poulton near Cirencester. We're a mixed farm here, which means that we have livestock as well as arable cropping. Our livestock comprises of a large herd of pedigree beef shorthorn cattle, a large flock of sheep and a varied amount of arable cropping. Our arable crops run to milling wheat to make bread flour, biscuit wheat for a well-known variety of biscuits, feed wheat and feed barley to make livestock food, malting barley to make beer, maize, beans, peas, triticale, buckwheat, phacelia, and oilseed rape. Even though we are considered a conventional farm, i.e. not organic, our first port of call when doing anything to a crop always comes from an environmental point of view. We endeavour at all points to never use an artificial chemical or an artificial input if there is another way around the situation. Part of being able to do this is having a very healthy soil that can help support and feed the crops that we're trying to grow. Being able to help improve our soils means that we use the livestock in close conjunction with how we crop the arable side of the farm. Part of this is using herb and legume-rich grass lays as a break crop within our arable rotation. These allow fields to have a rest from growing cereal crops, which means we can deal with weeds that we struggle to control within the cereal crop itself, and also helps build organic matter and biological life in the soil. As well as using grass as a break crop within the system, we also use the livestock very actively on the arable side of the farm. Over the winter and in the early spring, we endeavour to graze nearly all of our cereal crops with sheep. So this is a direct drill crop of winter wheat. This is destined to be made into a well-known brand of biscuits after harvest. And this is one of the blocks of ground that we grazed with sheep in the autumn, or in the sort of middle part of the winter. So they tend to take it right back down to its base, down there, and they remove all the old diseased leaves that have gathered up disease over the winter. And they also encourage it to produce more stems per plant. So each plant now has on average 4 stems rather than maybe 3. Each will then produce an ear, so therefore it increases yield. And by removing all the disease in the winter, we have got to a stage where, apart from trace elements to this field and a little bit of artificial nitrogen, we have not had to apply any form of ag chem to keep it from clean from disease or to regulate its growth, which is obviously quite a nice win for nature. Around all of our arable fields, we leave these 6 meter wide grass margins. These provide us space and habitat for wildlife to live in, especially when we've harvested this crop of winter barley and there's no cover for things like dormice and field mice to hide in. These margins give them a safe place to try and avoid predators. As well as grazing growing cereal crops on the farm, we also use the spare ground when we're not growing a cereal after harvest to grow a cover crop. These comprise of a mixture of brassica crops, cereals, and other broadleaf crops that help to use up any nitrogen that has been left over from the previous cereal crop. Therefore, it doesn't get wasted and end up in a watercourse. These cover crops we graze in the autumn with the sheep, and it allows us to fatten lambs at a time of year where grass growth can be very slow and utilises the farm to the best of its ability. The cover crop is then left to grow back over the winter. This keeps the soil alive as there is a root system within it, engaging with the soil bacteria, which allows our soils to be more healthy. So this is a crop of direct drilled spring malting barley, which we had the cover crops in over the winter. These are some of the remnants of the cover crop that the sheep grazed, and we slot the barley straight in narrow bands, disturbing as little soil as possible and leaving as much detritus and rubbish on the surface as we can to turn into organic matter. And these tall mustard stems that are dead, their roots go deep into the soil, allowing water when it rains to infiltrate into the soil profile rather than wash off the surface. Another way in which we endeavour to improve the ecological and biological life of the farm is by not using any insecticides. This is a crop of winter oilseed rape that's just coming towards the end of its flowering. It's replacing these yellow flowers with the pods that hold the seed. Now, we don't use insecticides on this farm, and there is a problem with a little beetle called flea beetle, which like to eat these plants in the early autumn when they're just establishing. Now, to get round the fact that we don't use insecticides to control them, we plant our oilseed rape with a companion crop. This companion crop is a variety of clovers, and it hides the oilseed rape from the beetle. And then we remove the clover in the early winter and allow the oilseed rape to come up above it. And then it turns into a lovely looking yellow crop like this. Mixed in with the arable side of the farm, we also have a large environmental stewardship scheme. These areas provide either nectar plots, birdseed plots, nesting sites, habitats, or space for water. All of these things together hopefully combine to make sure that we have a viable and active ecosystem within the farm. This all helps towards controlling pests and diseases that we don't want. So this is one of our environmental stewardship plots. The middle here is full of things like phacelia, this purple stuff which we grow the seed for, and a variety of other flowering plants, and there are also some cereals in there that will come up later. And at the moment it's providing nectar for the bees and other pollinators, some of which are very busy at the moment. And then around the outside we've planted a new mix which will be mainly cereal based to feed wild birds this winter. And then just down there where that tractor is, there is another 4 acres of birdseed along the bottom of that field, which joins that wood in the distance all the way around to this wood behind me, meaning we have a corridor for the wildlife to live and move along around our farming, and hopefully we don't interfere with them too much, and hopefully it benefits them. All of these factors combined in the way in which we farm means that we aim to produce high quality, low carbon and environmentally sustainable food to end up on a supermarket shelf for you, the consumer.
Thank you very much, Will, and thank you, Ed, for your video. Now, the questions are starting to fly in for you, Ed, so we better rattle through them as quickly as we can. First one was quite specific about the ratios of your herb and legume in the mix, if you could answer that one.
So they are 50-50 grass and legumes. So it's half sort of perennial ryegrass, fescues, timothy, and then half clover, sainfoin, plantain, lucerne, and a couple of things that I can never quite remember or pronounce.
A question just on the expectations of your yields on Cotswold brash.
In a normal year, we would look somewhere around the 8.5 tonne to the hectare for wheat and 7.5 for barley. This year, I think there'll be remarkably reduced.
Absolutely. I know where you are with that one, Ed. Now there's a question about fertiliser use and sort of allied to that one on soil testing. So one question is asking you, have you managed to reduce your fertiliser use because of the cover crops and the companion cropping? And then the other question about soils is, do you test your soils? And if so, what do you test them for?
Yes, we have managed to reduce our fertiliser inputs. In some cases, we have managed to reduce them by about 40% and still keep our yields the same. Other crops are slightly more touch and go, and we experiment with stuff and play with things the whole time. So yeah, as our soils get more active and more alive, we are managing to reduce artificial inputs of fertilizer and keep our yields the same. And on the soil testing, so yes, we test everything every 3 years. We have a 3-year cycle around all of the farms, so we test for organic matter, active carbon, so sort of a test of how well the soil is functioning as a biological sort of entity. Also, you know, pH, nitrogen, P, K, so the sort of major elements. We also test for minor elements such as iron, molybdenum, zinc, boron. So we try and build up as big a picture as possible, so we have lots of reference points to work out where we're getting it right.
Fantastic. And the final two questions. One on the rape and clover for the two of them. Do you drill them together? And a different question on just what breed of sheep you.
So we drill the companion crop for the oilseed rape. We will drill straight behind the combine in August. So as soon as we can behind winter barley, we will put the companion crop in to make it create its canopy and start doing its job. And then we then won't drill the oilseed rape. We don't start until the second week of September to avoid the main flea beetle pressure window. So those two things together seemingly seem to make it work. We are yet to lose a crop of rape to flea beetle. And we have two flocks of sheep. We have a flock of pure breed Clanwenog Welsh mountain sheep that look a bit like Shaun the Sheep from TV. And we have a flock of Texel cross mules, bog standard white fluffy sheep.
Thank you very much, Ed. Same goes to any more questions, put them in on the chat. But Will, if we can move on to, is it David now?
Super. Thank you, James. Thank you, Ed. Yeah, we're going to go across the county a little bit to Stroud to see a day in the life of a dairy farmer with Liz and Lily Godsell at Godsell's Cheese.
Today is Tanker Day, so we are sending off about 8,900 litres at the moment. Not quite full, our tank holds 10,000 litres altogether. But quite a lot of milk in there. So I've got the footage in coming at 10 o'clock, which is 9:15, so I'm going to go and get some breakfast because I am starving. I'm cows milking. You can see I'm just walking the cows down, got the last few ones in. Been a pretty hot day, hence why I'm covered. Pretty standard. Yeah, so see what tomorrow brings. This morning Josh was milking, put the cows in, just put the fence up as they are in the field this morning. It's raining! There's going to be a lot of happy cows this morning.
Forming just on the end there, and there's his hocks, which is the equivalent of our ankles. And then going forward, you can have a look. There's the navel.
Brilliant. Teach me to read the running list a bit better, but thank you, Will. So, Liz, first question we've got for you is about free range. So if you can explain what free range dairy is to people, please.
Right. Well, there's a group of us of eight dairy farmers that supply Cottiswold in Tewkesbury, and we're trying to gain ourselves a little bit extra money for our milk. So through the hard work of a chap called Neil Darwin, he very strongly believes that cows should graze grass, and obviously the eight dairy farmers that are in free range believe that too. So he has actually managed to get us a premium for our milk, which is absolutely amazing. So what we promise with free range is that we will graze our cows for 180 days and 180 nights. So they're allowed to have a little bit of feed when they come in for milking, but they have to be shut in the field to guarantee that they are grazing grass. And it kind of seems a little bit odd. Well, you know, most people assume cows do graze grass. So we definitely do. And we think it's a natural way for cows to eat, and it allows them to express their natural behaviour as well. And the cream, the milk is absolutely divine.
Excellent. Now there's a question about what happens to the heifers.
The heifers, we rear all our own replacements. So they are obviously fed on milk, and then they move on to concentrates. So we will rear them on farm till they're about 2 1/4, when they will have their own baby calf and enter into the milking herd.
Couple of questions on cheese side of things, Liz. What cheeses do you make, but also how do you make cheese?
Right, well, obviously with cheese you need milk, and we've got plenty of that. So we started making cheese back in 2001, We were just about to start and make our first batch, and the news came through that there was an outbreak of foot and mouth. So that actually stopped us doing anything for the 6 months. At the beginning, we weren't quite sure whether we were going to concentrate on hard cheese or soft cheese, so we made both. But we've ended up just making hard cheese. Although it takes you longer to mature, it sat on the shelf sort of maturing, not actually bringing the money back in. But it gives you such a big window over which you can sell the cheese, particularly at Christmas. So it doesn't matter if a cheese matures on or if you eat it a little bit earlier. But the cheeses that we make, the first cheese that we made was cheddar, because I've read somewhere that if you did a survey on 100 people's fridges, you'd find it in 70. So we thought that was a good cheese. Then we realised we're in Gloucestershire, perhaps we should have a go at double Gloucester. And then somebody told us about single Gloucester, and that's got a PDO. So you have to own some Gloucester cows to make single Gloucester. And then we've done lots of different things. Every time we made a mistake when we were making cheese, we tended to create a new cheese. So for example, our smoked cheese was actually my attempt at trying to make a Cheshire cheese, and it kept going wrong. And we thought, what can we do with this? We sent it to somebody with a smoker, and it tasted really good. So that was another new cheese. So we are quite good with our names and new cheeses.
Thank you, Liz. There's another question to pick up on the chat, but just in order to keep to time, if I could just remind people what Will said earlier on, that if you can turn your feedback. Liz, hopefully you can answer a couple more questions that are appearing on the chat. And Will, if we can move on to the next video, please.
Thank you, everyone. Thank you, James. Thank you, Liz. Thank you, Lily. I've just had a go at muting all again, but just a reminder to keep mics off and stuff like that so everyone can hear. Right, to the next farm we're going to. It's just up the hill from Liz in the Cotswolds, and it's David Barton. Apologies all, I'll try that again.
My name's David. I'm a farmer in the Cotswolds, and we have a family farm where we grow cereals, wheat and barley, and we have a beef suckler herd. And today I'm just going to talk about the beef sucklers. These are cows which calve down in the spring, produce a calf for us, and the cows feed the calf all through the season, and we don't take any of the milk. It's a really good way to produce quality beef. Our cows graze on our banks and meadows, and the way in which they graze is they tear out the grass with their tongues, and it leaves an open pasture, and that's really essential for our species-rich grassland to really flourish, and all the small plants can benefit from this. And so our cattle are weaned in about in the autumn, in September, October, and the cows then have a rest for a couple of months before they calve again. The cows just eat grass that we produce on the farm, and in the winter when they come in for maybe 6 to 8 weeks, they have some hay that we produce in the summer. The calves that are weaned, we feed those on some cereals as well, but mostly it's grass silage. So everything that the cattle need is grown on the farm, so it's a really sustainable way of producing beef, which is a really good source of protein. And it's very sustainable in the way in which we do it. We use everything. The cereals that we grow, we use the straw for the cattle, and in turn they turn that into manure, and we put that back on the fields, and that helps us grow the next year's crop. So it's a really good cycle of growing cereals and beef sustainably, Everything that we produce is to the red tractor standard, so you can be assured of its welfare and quality. Two stock bulls on the farm. The first one is Herod. He's our senior stock bull, and he's a Saleres bull, a French breed. He's bred in the UK, but he's about 6 years old, weighs in around about 1,200 kilos. We like him very much because he's produces very easy calving calves, and his heifers that we use afterwards also are very easy calving, so that's really important for us. Also produces a really nice carcass, which is also very important, that fits the market for today. We also have Endeavour, who is a Sussex bull, obviously a native breed. He's small, he's around about 900 kilos. And we use him on some of our replacement heifers predominantly to bring our cow size down a bit, because we don't want our cows to be too big. We want nice medium-sized cows that don't cost too much to feed throughout the year. Both of these bulls have very good temperaments, which is also really important, that we don't have any nasty cows or aggressive cows. We don't want those. So these bulls both produce nice, docile animals, which is really, really important. So after one of the wettest winters that we've ever experienced here at Manor Farm, it's been followed by one of the driest springs. So April and May have been incredibly dry. May has been a lovely month with lots of sunshine and really warm. Unfortunately, we've run out of moisture for the soil, and that means the grass has stopped growing. So we are moving the cows around the farm. We do that on a rotation, and basically we're just about to run out of grass. So we desperately need some rain. We've had some just yesterday a little bit, but we need a considerable amount of rain over sort of a week or 10 days really to bring the soil moisture back up to where it needs to be. It's very, very dry, so it's quite a challenge finding enough fodder to feed the cows during the summer when it's like this. We've actually made silage, and that the first cut wasn't too bad, maybe 80%. We've now made some hay. The earliest we've ever made it, we baled it on the 1st of June. And that crop sadly was about 50% of what it should have been, and we don't have any second cut silage coming along just because it doesn't rain. So as soon as it rains, it will improve, and the amount of rain we get will determine how much the improvement is, and hopefully we're going to be able to make up some silage in the autumn, which will help out. But it's certainly being a challenge this year.
Oh, James, I think you're on mute.
Very much. Well, yes, David. Obviously, the dry weather that you mentioned there has affected the whole of the county, and it still is, although the odd person's had a bit of rain, but not sufficient. So the first question comes up, it's a challenge, I know, to you, but what is your process? What are you going to do if you run out of pasture?
Well, we're currently grazing our what should be our second cut silage, and that's going to take me through a few more days. And it is starting to get really quite serious, actually, because I can start feeding hay and straw to the cattle, which is really, you know, put by for next winter. And it's really just a case of just hanging on there until it rains. It's really difficult because this is not a situation that I'm used to being in. We had it in 2018, but it came a lot later. So the plan is, I'm not really sure, because as soon as it rains, it improves. But at the moment, it's really difficult. So we're just taking every day as it comes and making sure that the cattle have something to eat and they're happy. And if necessary, we will have to start feeding. We have just started feeding some hay. So we will just continue to do that until it rains and hope that we can make it up in the autumn with a good with a good cut of silage then, maybe.
Yes, I mean, farmers are quite often characterised as fretting about the weather all the time, but I suppose it's just a proof that, you know, we are vulnerable to the climate that we have, and it can have a huge impact on our business, which is why we're concerned about it. But there's nothing we can do about it, not in the short term anyway. So as you say, we have to just wait for the weather to change. Next question is asking you, how do you market your beef?
Okay, so I actually produce beef for Dovecote Park, and apart from a few that we actually do for ourselves for a box scheme, they all go up to Dovecote, which is supplying Waitrose.
Have you seen that box scheme increase at all because of COVID?
Yeah, we actually had a steer ready just as it sort of all happened, and we actually sold it out very quickly. So yeah, there is a real demand, and people are really looking to source locally and you know, looking for sustainable products as well. So it's from that point of view, COVID's actually been one of the positives that's come out of it.
Yeah, so certainly we're hoping that people feel a lot more connected to where their food comes from, as you say, as a positive out of what has been a fairly negative situation for most. So roughly what age are the cattle when they're fit for slaughter?
Okay, so what we're doing is we're producing them now around about 22 to 24 months old, and we have actually been trying to sort of finish them slightly earlier. Always thinking about our carbon footprint, and we've probably managed to get them to slaughter about 2 months earlier than we used to about 4 or 5 years ago, but also taking a balance in that, you know, we are using grass a lot, so we are slightly limited, but that's around the age, 23 months on an average, that we're that they go to slaughter.
And probably a final question for you, David, just on the issue with COVID and the capacity at slaughterhouses, have you been impacted by that?
Yeah, Dovecote actually have two plants, and they shut one down and furloughed it because we've seen demand initially went up very high. It then fell back, and it's now very strong again. So actually beef is in demand, and it's thriving. So they seem to be managing, and at the moment, yep, all the plants seem to be coping with it and with a strong demand. So from a perspective of a beef farmer, that's good news.
Thank you very much indeed, David. So back over to you, Will.
Thank you, James. Thank you, David. So James, I think we're actually going to come and have a look around your crops now, if that's okay. So yeah, next film will be James Cox.
My name is James Cox, and I'm currently Gloucestershire NFU's County Chairman. And I would like to welcome you to a virtual tour of Hazelcote Farm, Kingscote. Hazelcote Farm is an all-arable farm where we grow milling wheat, malting barley and oilseed rape. Whilst we crop about 85% of the farm, 6% of the farm is woodland, and we are particularly concerned at the moment with the issue of the ash dieback disease, and we are going to have to carefully manage that to remove the diseased trees and, where necessary, plant new species. Main woodland and woodland belts are linked by over 5 kilometres of hedgerow and 2 kilometres of dry stone wall, along with many of our stewardship strips. We have been in stewardship schemes for over 20 years at Hazelcote Farm, and currently we have over 10% of our land in stewardship options, including pollen and nectar mixes, floristically enhanced margins, birdseed mixes, plots for skylarks and for lapwings. A survey last spring, following one we had done at the beginning of our HLS agreement in 2012, showed that our breeding farmland bird numbers had doubled and that we had introduced several new bird species to the farm as well. Going forward, new elm schemes will hopefully acknowledge the good work already taking place on our farms and look to develop that into the future. Will this be the last year we see oilseed rape being grown on this farm? Many of you will know that a seed treatment containing the insecticide neonicotinoid was banned in the country a few years ago. This treatment, used to control the cabbage stem flea beetle that we are now seeing ravage the oilseed rape crop across the county and the country, mainly causing the crop to fail just after it's planted, but larvae also develop in the spring to give a second devastating impact. Oilseed rape offers a fantastic early source of pollen for the bees that the local beekeeper has on our farm, but the risk of growing the crop have become too great, and the source of pollen is likely to be lost. And yet, we are importing oilseed rape into this country produced using the seed treatment that is banned here. British farmers and pollinators are all losing out. The winter wheat crops we grow here are all milling varieties, and we have a contract to supply Warburtons. The unprecedented amount of rainfall over autumn and winter made establishing these winter crops very difficult, but we have been luckier than most, and now we have to manage them and harvest them in good condition for the premium market that we are targeting. Spring malting barley is the most important crop we grow at Hayscote Farm. It quite often takes up 50% of our cropped area, and we are part of the Molson Coors Growers Group that supplies approximately 40% of their malting barley requirement for their brewery in Burton-on-Trent, where they use 100% British barley. Following the wet weather I've already mentioned, we have now entered a prolonged dry spell, which has not helped the spring barley crop in particular. But by reducing the amount of soil moved when establishing the crop, we are quite pleased with how it is looking. The biggest challenge for malting barley has come from the lockdown necessary because of COVID. The closure of pubs, clubs and restaurants saw 45% of the beer market disappear overnight.
Thank you, James.
Yeah, thank you, Will. And I thought I was going to get away without a single question, which would have been quite good for asking myself a question. I haven't had anything on the weather, on the quality of our grains. And I guess the issue is that actually the wheat, well, all the grains are suffering yield-wise, and that might have an impact on some of the quality aspects. But probably the wheat at the moment is not so so much of a worry. Our malting barley is a big worry because they have a low to be able to get a good alcohol extract out of it. And the chances are that because of the dry spell, we might not hit malting spec, and that would obviously be quite damaging for our sales. But it's a problem. But as we've said before, the weather is not something we have a lot of control over. All we can try and do is make our business is sort of resilient. On the oilseed rape, I have managed to keep all my crop this year. One half of it, which we direct drilled, is slightly better than the other half where we moved the soil first. And that is also very short. So it's showing the effects of the flea beetle larvae that meant it didn't grow away in the autumn. We're looking like it. We won't be growing as much oilseed rape in the future. We're going to have to find alternative break crops on our farm. Do I know what alcohol my malting grains go to make? Well, as I say, if we're brewery up at Burton-on-Trent that we grow for some of the barley can also go to the breweries where they produce their bitters as well. You have to have a slightly different specification, even lower nitrogen content if you want to use it for distilling to produce your whiskies. How would I like to control flea beetle? It would be wonderful if we had technology that made had varieties that were resistant, because obviously in an ideal world, we prefer to not use pesticides. So if we can actually have a technology in the breeding technique that would make the plant resistant to flea beetle, that would be the ideal solution. But what we do know is that if it is possible, is quite a few years away. And as far as the straw, we have our straw baled and collected by local livestock farmers. But we incorporate the straw behind the oilseed rape. So we're incorporating 1 year in full. Probably best if we move on, Will, to the next video.
Absolutely. Thank you very much, James. So we've got three more farms that we would like to show you around. And the next one we're going to is Rob Harrison's up in Shipping Camden.
Hi, my name's Rob Harrison. I'm a dairy farmer by Chipping Camden in North Gloucestershire. We farm just over 200 milking cows here, trying to produce milk as sustainably, environmentally friendly as possible, producing a healthy, nutritious product. Now, most people hopefully get to enjoy milk on a daily basis, whether that's milk on your cereal or in your tea and coffee, cheese on your pizza or yogurt. And we've got to make sure, it's my responsibility as a dairy farmer to make sure that I have happy, healthy cows, which produce healthier and more nutritious milk. And critically, it's really important that as farmers, we look after the environment. We've seen ourselves over the last couple of years, we're currently suffering from really dry weather, that actually the environment is so important to where we live, and it affects all of us around the world. So actually we've all got to do our part. So what we've done on this farm, everything is all about grazing. So you can hopefully see my cows grazing away behind me. And we try and get the best use out of grass that we possibly can. We're also growing lots of trees and hedges around the farm to soak up carbon, as well as trying to farm in a sustainable way, whether that's using solar panels to produce electric for milking, or also trying to reduce our energy use by grazing cows rather than using tractors to make silage. And other ways of harvesting, although we still do need to use tractors for other parts of the farming operation. We're in organic conversion here, so we're trying to, or we're in the process of reducing our fertilizer use. So we're not putting any fertilizer on, so eventually we'll be selling organic milk. And also we try and educate the next generation. So we're having school children on farm, up to 100 classes of school children are coming on farm before we were shut down in COVID. And they're looking around the farm, they're learning about where their food comes from, they're learning about the natural environment, whether that's hedgerows, about the opportunities to come walking, access onto the farm, and just really understanding a little bit about the environment and the countryside. That's a little bit more about my farm, and we'll just have a few pictures to take you round. So these are crossbred calves from the dairy herd. So the dairy crosses are reared, and at 2 years old they come into a dairy herd, but also we cross some of them with a beef sire, and they're reared up and they become prime beef, so for people to eat. Again, they're grazed around the farm in the luscious pastures of the Cotswolds, and reared in a healthy and happy way to provide sustainable food for everyone around the country. These are 11-month-old dairy-bred Angus cattle, destined for the food chain, all busy eating grass. This is the classroom where the children visit our farm 365 days a year, rain or shine. Children and adults are learning all about where their food comes from, all about different farming practices, all about nature, and all about farming within the natural environment. Obviously a lot of children grow up in an urban environment, and it's great just to get them outside, getting muddy, and just really enjoying being outside on the farm.
I love milk because it makes me good at sport. I love milk because it makes me big and strong.
Woo!
What do you reckon?
Thank you, Rob.
Excellent. Rob, just interested to know, what are the yields that you're aiming for, Rob? And obviously, I suppose now that you're looking at this organic conversion, perhaps you might be able to make a comparison between what you were getting and what your expectation is under the organic system.
We were quite extensive anyway. So for the last probably 15 years, we've really been trying to get more and more milk from forage and not feeding. So we feed about probably over a course of a year, we feed about a ton of concentrate or grain per cow, and we're averaging about 6,000 litres a cow a year. So for our 200 cows, we produce just over 1 million litres
over the course of 12 months, which we sell to Arla. And hopefully, organically, we're planning on maintaining those kind of yields because we're not feeding huge amounts of concentrate to those cows.
And how long does it actually take to turn organic? Or
so it's a 2-year conversion process. So we're almost through the first 12 months of that. So we started kind of last summer. And so we haven't used any sprays or fertilizer. And then in the last 6 months of that, we convert the animals. So we convert all the land to start off with, and then all the animals are converted towards the end. So at the minute, we still can manage the animals conventionally, but the land is managed very crudely. Is managed organically.
There's a question on the breed of the cows that you use, and whether you would change that breeding as you convert.
So as I said, we were quite extensive before, and we sell our milk to Arla, so we get paid for milk constituents. So we produce like very creamy milk with high butter fat and protein. So for a number of years, we've been crossbreeding our cows. So the predominant breed we use is Friesian, but we also cross them with a Jersey, which gives premium milk. And we've also used other breeds like Ayrshire and Montbelliard, and they all have, you know, good traits. So some of them have got better feet and legs, so when they're walking around the fields, and some of them have, you know, higher disease resistance, things like that. So we're trying to use different traits to try and make animals that last longer and are better at grazing and converting forage to milk.
And probably the final question for you, Rob, is about the education room, which I think everyone... what he thought was very impressive, and just wondering to what area, what schools can come.
So the farm is near Evesham, actually, in Worcestershire, and generally it's kind of schools within kind of a 20-minute, half an hour radius. Most of the kids that come out will be primary school age, but we do quite a few kind of special needs groups as well. And a few secondary school kids, but majority is kind of primary school kids, and very much kind of tailoring around the national curriculum and some of the topics that they're doing in class.
Fantastic, Rob. Thank you very much indeed. Will, back over to the next video, please.
Thank you, James. Thank you, Rob. So the next farm, penultimate farm that we're going to, it's just down the road from Rob in Winchcombe, and so we're going to go to Charles Day's place.
Hi, my name is Charles Day, and welcome to our virtual farm tour on our farm around Winchcombe near Cheltenham. We are an arable farm growing milling wheat, linseed, oilseed rape, beans, spring onions, and vining peas. Our milling wheat is used to make flour. The spring onions and vining peas are grown with Sandfield Farms and EVG. These are hand-picked and processed in their packhouses and then arriving at your local supermarket. In 2017, we planted a cider and perry tree orchard. There are quite a few different varieties of trees to help with pollination. We have Brandy, Helen's Early, Blakeney Red and Green Horse that make up the perry trees. Three Counties, Prince William and Helen's Apple are the side of apple varieties. The trees produce their fruit once a year. We harvest them in late September, early October. This is done mechanically, as the appearance of the fruit is not important. The trees are shaken and the fruit that has fallen on to the floor is blown into the middle of the row, where our harvester sweeps them up. The apples and pears go to local craft cider produces. We have bees in the orchard to help pollinate the trees and during the spring with the blossom on the trees. We have also planted a nectar mix made up mostly of sainfoin and red clover. This provides extra food for the bees throughout the summer. Earlier this year, when the weather allowed us, we were part of a project for the River Isbourne catchment, working with the Environment Agency and Worcestershire County Council to create leaky dams and attenuation ponds. Together, these help maintain a constant flow, as the leaky dam allows water to slowly pass through to provide protection from surges of water and flooding further down the river.
Thank you, Charles. James, you're on mute.
You'd have thought I got used to this now, wouldn't you? But sorry about that, everybody. Charles, interesting the cider and perry orchard that you've got there. Have you had it established long, and sort of what are the yields that you're expecting from it?
Hi, James, and everyone. Thank you for the question. So, this, as I mentioned, we planted the cider and perry orchard in 2017. At that point, the trees were already 2 years old. They were grafted in Herefordshire and then brought over and planted in April 17. And so they're growing well now, as you can see in the video. And last year's yield, we were hoping for about 8 tons, as they're still only young trees. But we only really got 4 tons, which is similar to what we achieved the previous year. So at the moment, we're hoping that they sort of double their yields year on year, until roughly they will get to about 20 tons a year, roughly, yield, hopefully, weather allowing.
And what area is that on, Charles?
So where we planted the trees was previously a desert orchard, fruit orchard. It's sort of in a microclimate not far from Hales Abbey, where the monks used to grow other sort of fruit trees and so on. So we know it can produce fruit and tree, you know, growing trees really well. So that's why we decided to do it there. It's very steep banks, didn't really show it that well in the videos, but yeah, we wouldn't be able to drive our combine up and down those banks. So the best thing for it was some cider trees.
And who do you sell the fruit to? And also, another question asking you about the sort of skills you've had to learn, new skills about pruning, or do they not need pruning?
Oh, no, they certainly need pruning to get the sort of the trees that we sort of saw the most of the video of was the perry trees, and they're really tall. And to get them growing really tall, you had to prune them and guide the leader, which is the tallest leading branch on the tree up there. So yeah, we certainly had a steep learning curve, and we're still learning. We'll never stop learning with the orchard. As to where the cider goes to, the apples and perry pears go to, they go to all over really, mostly locally. So we've got a few local cider makers in and around sort of Winchcombe area. And we've got one chap who takes the perry pears. He's based in Cirencester, and he makes a gin. And that's very, very popular in Italy. So it goes all over the world at the moment, which is really good to see. So the varieties pretty much ripen at the same time. I can see that question.
Yeah, you had a mixture of varieties, but you still obviously can harvest them in one. So that keeps it simple. And I suppose the final question we'll ask you is just sort of the density, you know, how many trees per hectare, or what sort of hectareage have you got in trees?
Yeah, roughly that is, we've planted 10 acres, so I'm going old school, and there is about 4,000 trees in that acreage. So it's quite dense to get that level of fruit cropping eventually.
Brilliant. Thank you very much, Charles. And Will, over to you for probably the final video.
Thank you, James. Thank you, Charles. Right, at last, but by no means least, we are going down south of Cirencester to have a look at Chris Rumming's farm.
Hi, my name is Chris Rumming and welcome to our farm tour. I farm at Park Farm, which is on the edge of Swindon. We farm cattle, sheep and turkeys. At the centre of all our farming decisions, we put the environment and biodiversity, and it's really affecting the direction of our farm progress and what we're aiming to do. We are a conventional farm, we're not organic, but like I say, the environment is the key to all our decisions, and we are certified producers of pasture-fed beef. The sheep and the cattle and the turkeys, we all aim to sell direct to our customers, so we're not supplying supermarkets or any large retailers. In the last few months, it's been quite different, and demand for the beef and the sheep and the lamb and the mutton, rather, has been far greater than previous years. So we're very fortunate. We've got our own little on-site butchery, so we process all the animals ourselves, and we can sell it through our online shop and get it directly out to customers. We've been delivering much more of the produce this year than previous years. Normally what we do is we have collection days and the customers come to us, but this year so far we've been taking the meat boxes out to our customers, and we tend to supply people in a sort of a 10 to 15 mile radius. We're doing lots of really interesting environmental projects on the farm. This year we've just planted 20 acres of a herbal lay, which is a really interesting crop, which is a mixture of lots of different grasses and flowering plants like chicory, yarrow, sheep's parsley, birdsfoot trefoil, loads of things in there which will be brilliant for the grazing animals, but also, just as importantly, be fantastic for wildlife. So the insects and the birds will really love it. The chicory should provide lots of seeds, and the rest of it should provide really good homes for pollinators. Another thing that we're really interested in doing is maintaining our hedges to maximise biodiversity. So we cut the hedges either every year, every other year, or every third year. And by having different areas of the farm managed in different styles, it gives us a range of habitats. So the hedges that are cut every year are really good for nesting birds because they're really nice and dense. The hedges that are cut every third year provide a lot more fruit. So the winter birds, things like field fares, red wings, things like that will get much more benefit because we've got a lot more sloes and blackberries and things like that. Anyway, I'm going to take you around the farm and show you a bit more of our wildlife and livestock. So these are some of our cows. We run them behind an electric fencing system, which is the cable you can see along the front of there, and that gives us a great deal of control over how they graze the grass by affecting how large an area we give them. We can control how short they graze it, and again, also we can also regulate how quickly we move them. It's really good because it allows us to keep the grass healthier and therefore the soil healthier. The soil is the key to everything, really. We don't use any fertilisers, so the natural manure and the health of the soil is the key to what drives our grass growth. These cattle will be moved every day onto a new section of grass, so they like it and we like the fact that we can control what's going on. So I've just looked in this dung pat and I found this fantastic dung beetle. Dung beetles are absolutely essential for recycling nutrients in the soil, and what you find is actually on the underside there, if you could see, is he's actually carrying lots of mites around with him. If I turn him over, there we go, on the underside there, if you could just see them, there are all these little tiny mites, those little red dots on there, and those are actually called ferretic mites, and they will parasitize any flies that lay their larvae into this dung pat. So not only are the beetles recycling the dung into the soil, but they're also reducing the flies that are around the farm, which would otherwise be irritating the cattle. So really important. So these are our breeding ewes. These are Oxford Downs, which are a rare breed. We really enjoy having a rare breed because it's nice to have a breed of sheep that is low in numbers and that we can help conserve. The sheep breed in end of January or early February, and then the lamb goes as lamb boxes. The ram lambs, we retain one or two just for breeding, some of the very best ones, and all the females stay with us either to expand the flock or for other people to start their own flocks. We're very lucky to have a couple of areas of water on the farm. We've got a couple of ponds, and this one here is behind the farm buildings. We've also got a stream that runs through the farm, which is great because it's good for water voles. The pond here has attracted kingfishers and otters in the past, so we built them this nesting bank, which you can see behind us. It's not been used yet,
but we do get regular visits from Kingfisher, so fingers crossed next spring we might have some breeding.
Thank you very much, Chris. Really fascinating. I think you've sort of pulled together the theme of the environment and sustainability there beautifully, because all the way through all of the films, I think that's shone through. We have a question for you on the herbal lays. How are they coping, assuming you're on perhaps shallow soils, but anyway, how are they coping with the dry weather? Would you recommend them? And do they do you graze them with both the sheep and the cattle? And if so, which is better?
Well, it's too early to say yet whether we'd recommend them, because it's the first year we've grown them. We planted it at the end of April when there was still just a little bit of moisture in the soil. And of course, since it went in, we've had virtually no rain at all. The chicory has got away pretty well. And I think the other things are hopefully hanging on in there. The rooks give it a bit of a hard time as well. And now the chicory's up, the pigeons have set about it. But we've got a bit of rain, hopefully, on the way in the next few days. So, yeah, it should be okay. The soil is, it's sort of brashy. So it's not particularly light and it's not heavy clay. But the main reason we wanted it was to give us some drought tolerance. Other parts of the farm are fairly light, so if we get it too hot too long, the pure grass mixes will die off a bit. So it was mainly for resilience. And in terms of cattle and sheep, yes, we hope to graze it with both. The cattle will be quite important. We want to give it a long rest period between grazing so we can get lots of flowers and lots of insects in there. So the cattle, if it gets too tall, will be important for actually trampling it down and getting on top of the growth there. But it would also be really beneficial to be able to graze the sheep on there as well, because quite a lot of the plants in there will have what they call anthelmintic properties. So it'll actually help to reduce the worm burdens within the livestock. So yeah, hopefully both.
Brilliant, thank you. And there's a question about how you cope with invasive weeds on your lays.
Well, very timely question, that is. We've got quite a bit of fat hen creeping into one corner. It was actually part of the field where previous years I'd grown a wild bird seed crop. So obviously the cultivation has brought up some of those seeds from the seed bank. So I'm just toying with the idea of whether I should top this fat hen or whether I should graze it. Because what I don't want really is for it to smother out the stuff that's in between. I mean, I don't mind a few weeds because, it's part of the ecosystem, isn't it? And they've all got a nutritional value to them as well. But this area that's got too much, I'm as long as it fits into the rotation of the way I'm grazing the cattle, I'd quite like to graze them down, trample them, and hopefully let the other things grow up through from underneath.
Brilliant. Thank you very much indeed, Chris. I'm conscious that we've probably gone a little beyond the hour and 10 minutes or whatever we thought we might do. It's probably crept up to nearly an hour and a half. So we've got a quick question for Chris, if you're still there, to answer about the dung beetles. Can you do anything to look after them?
Yes, you can do loads of things to benefit them. The first thing you can do is try and have livestock out on the land all year round. So obviously the cattle mainly come into the buildings through the winter. But we've got sheep around the fields all the time through the winter. So you've got, dung beetles, goes with the name, they need a constant source of dung, and different varieties will be out 12 months of the year. So that's the first thing. The next thing is we would never even consider using a chain harrow, because if you're going to disturb the dung, you won't get any dung beetles in them. And thirdly, and probably most importantly, is we try and do everything we can to reduce our use of insecticides. So cows and sheep, a bit like your cat and dog, we'll need an occasional insecticide treatment to make sure they don't get any parasites on them. But we try and do everything we can to use any insecticides in a way that is going to be least damaging to the dung beetles. So that mainly means, certainly with the cattle, we would only ever use insecticide in the winter when they're housed, so that the dung is then free of any residues by the spring. But yeah, once you start learning about dung beetles, you realise how integral they are to the whole sort of cycle of the soil and the ecology. So they're dangerously addictive to get into, but thoroughly recommended.
Okay, well, thank you, Chris. As I say, there is another question whether you can answer that on the chat, but as I say, I'm sort of keen probably to pull this to a close before people feel that we've taken up too much of their time. Just from my point of view, a huge thank you to Will, who's managed to pull this all together, and very much to all the farmers who have contributed today, giving up their time today, but also obviously putting the time and effort into the filming. It's been absolutely fantastic to see. Really pleased that we've been able to demonstrate all the good things that are going on farms in Gloucestershire. We're extremely proud of the food that we produce here, and we're looking to continue to produce as much food sustainably and environmentally friendly way for this country as well as this county. If I hand over to you, Will, for anything else.
Yeah, thank you, James, and thank you, everyone. I'm still slightly staggered that this seems to have worked without the internet breaking or anything going off or slightly going wrong. So, yeah, no, a huge thank you to everyone who's joined and asked questions. Really appreciate you taking the time and to have a look around our farms and over the farm gates, and also to our farmers who put a lot of time in to try to explain what they're doing, and some of the decisions which go on a daily basis with all kinds of conundrums to do with the weather, to do with pest, disease, markets, breeds, all of that sort of thing. So yeah, thank you, everyone. We have recorded this event, so we'll put it to a close now. We'll stop the recording, and if I can make the technology work, I'll try and circulate that recording of the link so that you can share this with other people who might find it interesting. Anyway, without further ado, I'll let you get on, and yeah, perhaps we could do it another time, but anyway, we'll call it a day there. Enjoy your Friday and have a good weekend.
Stay safe, everyone.
Thank you.